By the 1930s, scientists knew enough about space to be able to ask questions. What could observations from the edge of space reveal? What secrets of the atom might be discovered? The search for those discoveries was the start of the space race. By the beginning of the 1930s, other nations were ahead of the U.S. in terms of high-altitude exploration. They pursued their own scientific interests and left a lot of questions unanswered. Army Air Corps Captain Albert Stevens wanted to do more. Stevens sought funding and support from the Army, but was only promised logistical support and manpower. Stevens contacted the National Geographic Society, which shouldered the cost of his plans in the name of exploration and the reporting of it.
This is really where the experimentation and really where the flight setting altitude records made a big, big difference in the scientific research and the first step towards space.
A major expedition was organized. The Army assigned a three-man crew for the flight. Major William E. Kepner, pilot. Captain Orville Anderson, alternate pilot. Captain Albert Stevens, scientific observer.
Primarily, they wanted to study cosmic rays and what effect that has on humanity.
Stevens and Kepner were dispatched to locate a suitable site for a balloon launch. They chose an unusual landscape feature in South Dakota's Black Hills, a flat piece of protected ground surrounded by tall, steep cliffs. Calling on the resources of the South Dakota National Guard, Anderson directed construction of a camp in the gorge. The so-called Strato Camp served as construction site, mission control, and launch pad. A balloon manufactured by the Goodyear Zeppelin Company in Akron, Ohio was ordered and delivered. The balloon would be taken aloft by hydrogen. The expedition was ready to go in early July, but weeks passed as Major Kepner waited for perfect weather conditions. Finally, on July 27, 1934, the order was given to prepare for launch. At 5:45 a.m. on July 28th, the balloon was released. Seven hours into the flight, at an altitude of nearly 60,000 feet, the huge hydrogen balloon began to tear. Either a design or construction flaw caused some section of fabric to stick together and eventually rip under pressure. Kepner attempted a controlled descent, essentially using the torn balloon as a parachute, but eventually the entire balloon was in pieces. The crew had no choice but to bail out and rely on their own parachutes. The exit from the small hatch was clumsy, slow, and extremely risky. Kepner went first, bailing out at about 10,000 feet. Stevens bailed out at just 3,000 feet. The mission came to an end in a cornfield in south central Nebraska. Despite the nearly disastrous crash, the Explorer 1 flight was considered a success in terms of the information extracted from scientific instruments and film that survived the crash intact. The Army and the National Geographic Society were determined to try again. The Goodyear Zeppelin Company provided a larger balloon with slightly heavier fabric, a larger gondola and hatch, and one major difference. This balloon would be taken aloft by helium, not hydrogen. A launch attempt on July 12, 1935 was scrubbed when a safety feature on the balloon failed and the balloon could not be inflated. Goodyear fixed the problem, but it took months before another launch could be attempted. Finally, on November 11, 1935, Explorer 2 rose out of the Stratobowl carrying Explorer 1 veterans Captains Albert Stevens and Orville Anderson. Explorer 2 reached a height of 72,395 feet, a world record that stood for 20 years until another balloon launched from South Dakota's Stratobowl beat it by less than 4,000 feet. The flight lasted 8 hours and 12 minutes. Stevens conducted some 60 scientific experiments, measuring radiation intensity, ozone concentrations, and collecting air samples from different altitudes, monitoring sun intensity, barometric pressure, temperature, and on and on. Captain Stevens also took dozens of photos, including this one showing a view of western South Dakota.
Where they reached the top, that photograph became an iconic photograph, and it shows the curvature of the Earth. And that was the first time they could really see the curvature of the Earth.
Despite all the time aloft, Explorer 2 never crossed South Dakota's borders. Anderson and Stevens landed uneventfully near White Lake, some 225 miles east of their launch site. A quarter century later, after Air Force Captain Joe Kittinger set a high-altitude parachute jump world record, diving from a helium balloon at an altitude of 102,800 feet, he gave credit to the accomplishments of the Explorer flights.
Little did we know that in a few years, man would fly in space. And then after another few years, that man would walk in the moon. But it all started right here in the Stratobowl, Joe Kittinger.